They were conquerors, and for that you want only brute force. Nothing to boast of when you have it, since your strength is just an accident arising from the weakness of others. They grabbed what they could get for the sake of what was to be got. It was just robbery with violence, aggravated murder on a great scale, and men going at it blind, as is very proper for those who tackle a darkness. The Heart of Darkness is a fictional story written by novelist Joseph Conrad in 1899 about a voyage up the Congo River into the Congo Free State during the reign of King Leopold II of Belgium. Conrad's story, among other things, describes the systematic cruelty of Belgian rule in the Congo and criticizes the imperialist and racist agendas of the power-hungry colonial authorities at that time. However, this narrative seems to fit seamlessly into the setting of a post-colonial Congo as well, where the territory and its people would be subjected to foreign intervention, greed, large-scale corruption, and the protracted crisis that involved the world's major superpowers during the Cold War, namely the United States and the Soviet Union. This lecture will look at the Congo as a case study of decolonization. The Congo was colonized and ruled by the small European kingdom of Belgium in the late 19th century. The King of Belgium at the time, King Leopold II, was frustrated by Belgium's lack of international power and prestige, so he attempted to persuade the Belgian government to support colonial expansion around the then largely unexplored Congo Basin. The Belgian government's doubts about the idea led Leopold to eventually create the colony on his own account. In other words, the Congo was the personal dominion not of a country, but of one man. With support from a number of Western countries, who viewed Leopold as a useful buffer between rival colonial powers, Leopold achieved international recognition for a personal colony, the Congo Free State, in 1885. By the turn of the century, however, the violence of Congo Free State officials against the indigenous Congolese and the ruthless system of extraction of valuable raw materials led to intense diplomatic pressure on Belgium to take official control of the country. It did so, and the Belgian colony of the Belgian Congo was created in 1908. Belgian rule in the Congo was based around the colonial trinity, or trinité coloniale, of state, missionary, and private company interests. The privileging of Belgian commercial interests meant that capital sometimes flowed back into the Congo and that individual regions became specialized according to the demands of those commercial interests. On many occasions, the interests of the government and private enterprise became inseparable, and the state helped companies with suppressing indigenous labor through coercive laws. The country was split into hierarchically organized administrative subdivisions and run according to a set native policy, or politique indigène, in contrast to the British and the French, who generally favored the system of indirect rule. There was also a high degree of racial segregation. Large numbers of white immigrants who moved to the Congo after the end of World War II in 1945 came from across the social spectrum, but were nonetheless always treated as superior to blacks. During the 1940s and 1950s, the Congo experienced an unprecedented level of urbanization, and the colonial administration began various development programs aimed at making the territory into a so-called model colony. One of the results of the measures was the development of a new middle class of westernized African évolués, or so-called evolved and Europeanized Africans, who flowed to the cities. According to Bill Friend, by the 1950s, the Congo had a wage labor force twice as large as that of any other African colony. The Congo had a vast wealth in natural resources, including uranium, a key component for the building of a nuclear bomb. In fact, the uranium used in the making of the two atom bombs that were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki at the end of World War II is said to have come from the uranium mines of the Congo. This rich mineral wealth within the Congo led to substantial interest in the region from both the Soviet Union and the United States during the Cold War that started virtually immediately after the end of the Second World War in 1945. An African nationalist movement developed in the Belgian Congo during the 1950s, primarily among the Evolués. The movement was divided into a number of parties and groups which were broadly divided on ethnic and geographical lines and opposed to one another. The largest, the Mouvement National Congolais, or the MNC, was a united front organization dedicated to achieving independence within a reasonable time. It was created around a charter which was signed by, among others, a young postal clerk turned black nationalist leader named Patrice Lumumba, as well as other black nationalist leaders Cyril Adula and Joseph Elio. Lumumba became a leading figure within the MNC, and by the end of 1959, the party claimed to have 58,000 members. The MNC's main rival was the Alliance des Bakongo, or ABAKO, led by Joseph Kasavubu, who advocated a more radical ideology than the MNC, based around calls for immediate independence and the promotion of regional identity. ABAKO's stance was more ethnic nationalist than the MNC's. It argued that an independent Congo should be run by the Bakongo as inheritors of the pre-colonial kingdom of the Congo. The Confédération de l'Association Tribale du Katanga, or CONACAT, a localist party led by Moïse Tshombe, was the third major organization. It pushed for federalism and primarily represented the mineral-rich southern province of Katanga. These were joined by a number of smaller parties which emerged and as the nationalist movement developed, including the radical Parti Solidaire Africain, or the PSA, and factions representing the interests of minor ethnic groups like the Alliance des Bayanzi, or Abazi. Although it was the largest of the African nationalist parties, the MNC had many different factions within it that took differing stances on a number of issues. It was increasingly polarized between moderate Evolués and the more radical mass membership. A radical faction headed by Elio and Albert Kalonji split away in July 1959, but it failed to induce mass defections by other MNC members. The breakaway faction became known as the MNC Kalonji, or MNCK, while the majority group became the MNC Lumumba, or MNCL. The split divided the party's support base into those who remained with Lumumba, chiefly in the Stanleyville region in the northeast, and those who backed the MNCK, which became most popular around the southern city of Elizabethville and among the Luba ethnic group. Major riots broke out in Leopoldville, the Congolese capital, on 4 January 1959, after a political demonstration turned violent. The Force Publique, or the colonial army, used force against the rioters, with at least 49 people being killed, and total casualties were probably as high as 500. The Nationalist Party's influence expanded outside the major cities for the first time, and nationalist demonstrations and riots became a regular occurrence over the next year, bringing large numbers of black people from outside the Evolué class into the independence movement. Many blacks began to test the boundaries of the colonial system by refusing to pay taxes or abide by minor colonial regulations. The bulk of the ABAKO leadership was arrested, leaving the MNC with virtually no opposition. In the fallout from the Leopoldville riots, a report of a Belgian parliamentary working group on the future of the Congo was published, in which a strong demand for internal autonomy was noted. Auguste de Schryver, the Belgian minister of the colonies, launched a high-profile roundtable conference in Brussels in January 1960 with leaders of all the major Congolese parties in attendance. Lumumba, who had been arrested following riots in Stanleyville, was released in the run-up to the conference and headed the MNCL delegation. Issues including federalism, ethnicity, and the future role of Belgium in Congolese affairs were left unresolved after the delegates failed to reach agreement. According to writer Leo Zylik, the Belgian government had hoped for a period of at least 30 years before independence, but instead, Belgium gave the Congolese only 6 months to prepare for independence. The date for independence was set for 30 June 1960. The Belgians began to campaign against Lumumba, whom they wanted to marginalize because of his perceived radical ideology. They accused him of being a communist, and hoping to fragment the nationalist movement, supported rival ethnic-based parties like CONACAT. Many Belgians hoped that an independent Congo would form part of a federation, like the French Community or the British Commonwealth of Nations, and that close economic and political association with Belgium would continue. As independence approached, the Belgian government organized Congolese elections in May 1960. Lumumba and his MNC emerged victorious from these elections, leading to him being elected as Prime Minister of a soon-to-be independent Congo. Lumumba wanted complete independence, but because there was a gross shortage of competent administrators to govern the country, it was agreed that Belgium would continue to run the important departments of the new state, including the army, for the next 5 years. The proclamation of the Independent Republic of the Congo and the end of colonial rule occurred as planned on 30 June 1960, regarded by many political commentators as far too little time to prepare Congo for its independence. In a ceremony at the Palais de la Nation in Leopoldville, King Bodwa gave a speech in which he presented the end of colonial rule in the Congo as the culmination of the Belgian civilizing mission begun by Leopold II. After the king's address, Lumumba, in a surprise move, gave an unscheduled speech in which he angrily attacked colonialism and described independence as the crowning success of the nationalist movement. He said the following: "Our lot was 80 years of colonial rule. We have known tiring labor exacted in exchange for salary, which did not allow us to satisfy our hunger. We have known ironies, insults, blows, which we had to endure morning, noon, and night because we were Negroes. We have known that the law was never the same depending on whether it concerned a white or a Negro. We have known the atrocious suffering of those banished for political opinions or religious beliefs. We have known that there were magnificent houses for the whites in the cities and tumble-down straw huts for the Negroes." Lumumba's address was applauded by black nationalists all over the world, but it nearly provoked a diplomatic incident with Belgium. Even some Congolese politicians, including Kasavubu, perceived it as unnecessarily provocative. Lumumba was asked to apologize, which he did, but the Belgians saw this act as an insult and immediately plotted their revenge. Meanwhile, independence was celebrated across the Congo. Politically, the new state had a semi-presidential constitution known as the Loi Fondamentale, in which executive power was shared between the president and prime minister in a system known as bicephalism. Kasavubu was proclaimed president and Lumumba Prime Minister of the Republic of the Congo. Despite the objections of CONACAT and others, the constitution was largely centralist, concentrating power in the central government in Leopoldville, and did not devolve significant powers to provincial level. Despite the proclamation of independence, neither the Belgian nor the Congolese government intended the colonial social order to end immediately. The Belgian government hoped that whites might keep their position indefinitely. The Republic of the Congo was still reliant on colonial institutions like the Force Publique to function from day to day, and white technical experts were installed by the Belgians, were retained in the broad absence of suitably qualified black Congolese replacements, partly the result of colonial restrictions regarding higher education. Many Congolese people had assumed that independence would produce tangible and immediate social change, so the retention of whites in positions of importance was widely resented. Lieutenant General Emile Janssens, the Belgian commander of the Force Publique, refused to see Congolese independence as marking a change in the nature of command. The day after the independence festivities, he gathered the black non-commissioned officers of his Leopoldville garrison and told them that things under his command would stay the same, summarizing this point by writing "before independence equals after independence" on a blackboard. This message was hugely unpopular among the rank and file. Many of the men had expected rapid promotions and increases in pay to accompany independence. On 5 July 1960, several units mutinied against their white officers at Camp Hardy near Taysville. The insurrection spread to Leopoldville the next day, and later to garrisons across the country. Rather than deploying Belgian troops against the mutineers as Janssens had wished, Lumumba dismissed him and renamed the Force Publique the Armée Nationale Congolaise, or the ANC. All black soldiers were promoted by at least one rank. Victor Lundula was promoted directly from Sergeant Major to Major General and Head of the Army, replacing Janssens. At the same time, Joseph Désiré Mobutu, an ex-sergeant major and close personal aide of Lumumba, became Lundula's deputy as Army Chief of Staff. The government attempted to stop the revolt. Lumumba and Kasavuba intervened personally at Leopoldville and Taysville and persuaded the mutineers to lay down their arms. But in most of the country, the mutiny intensified. White officers and civilians were attacked, white-owned properties were looted, and white women were raped. The Belgian government became deeply concerned by the situation, particularly when white civilians began entering neighboring countries as refugees. The international press expressed shock at the apparent sudden collapse of order in the Congo, as the world viewed the Congolese situation prior to independence as peaceful, stable, and controlled by authorities, due largely to Belgian propaganda. On 9 July 1960, Belgium deployed paratroopers without the Congolese state's permission in Kabalo and elsewhere to protect fleeing white civilians. The Belgian intervention divided Lumumba and Kasavubu. While Kasavubu accepted the Belgian operation, Lumumba denounced it and called for all Congolese to defend our republic against those who menace it. At Lumumba's request, white civilians from the port city of Matadi were evacuated by the Belgian Navy on 11 July. Belgian ships then bombarded the city with at least 19 civilians killed during the attack. This action prompted renewed attacks on whites across the country, while Belgian forces entered other towns and cities, including Leopoldville, and clashed with Congolese troops. The Belgian government subsequently announced that it would provide for Belgian bureaucrats back in the metropole, triggering an exodus of most of the Congo's 10,000 European civil servants and leaving the administration in disarray. As a result of the disorder spreading throughout the country, most of the government ministries were unable to function. Meanwhile, on 11 July 1960, the same day as the Belgian evacuation at Matadi, Moïse Tshombe, the leader of CONACAT, declared the Congo's southern province of Katanga independent as the state of Katanga, with Elizabethville as its capital and himself as president. The Katanga region had traditionally shared closer economic ties with the copper belt of neighboring northern Rhodesia, today known as Zambia, than with the rest of the Congo, and because of its economic importance, it had been administered separately from the rest of the country under the Belgians. Konakat furthermore contended that Katangese people were ethnically distinct from other Congolese. The secession was partly motivated by the Katangese separatists' desire to keep more of the wealth generated by the province's mining operations and to avoid sharing it with the rest of the Congo. Another major factor was that Konakat held to be the disintegration of law and order in the central and northeastern Congo. Announcing Katanga's breakaway, Shombe said, "We are seceding from chaos." The major mining company in Katanga, the Union Minière de Haut-Katanga, or the UMHK, had begun supporting Konakat during the latter days of Belgian rule, and worries that the MNC might want to nationalize the company's assets after independence. The UMHK was largely owned by the Société Générale de Belgique, which was a prominent holding company based in Brussels that had close ties to the Belgian government. Encouraged by the UMHK, the Belgian government provided military support to Katanga and ordered its civil servants in the region to remain in their posts. Shombe also recruited mercenaries, mainly whites from South Africa, as well as northern and southern Rhodesia, to supplement and command Katangese troops. Although supported by the Belgians, Katanga never received formal diplomatic recognition from any country. The Katangese secession highlighted the fundamental weakness of the central government in Leopoldville, which had been the chief advocate of a unified state. Less than a month after the Katangese secession, on 8 August, a section of the region of Kasai, situated slightly to the north of Katanga, also declared its autonomy from the central government as the mining state of South Kasai, based around the city of Bakwanga. South Kasai was much smaller than Katanga, but was also a mining region. It was largely populated by the Luba ethnic group, and its president, Albert Kalonji, claimed that the secession was largely sparked by a persecution of the Baluba in the rest of the Congo. The South Kasai government was supported by Fourminier, another Belgian mining company, which received concessions from the new state in return for financial support. As can be seen, the private mining companies were directly influencing the political situation within the Congo in an attempt to protect their commercial interests. Without control over Katanga and South Kasai, the central government was deprived of approximately 40% of its revenues. Disquiet about Belgium's support for the secessionist states led to calls within the United Nations, or the UN, to remove all Belgian troops from the country. The Secretary General of the UN, Dag Hammarskjöld, believed that the crisis would provide the organization with a chance to demonstrate its potential as a major peacekeeping force and encouraged the sending of a multinational contingent of peacekeepers to the Congo under UN command. On 14 July, the UN Secretary Council adopted Resolution 143, calling for total Belgian withdrawal from the Congo and their replacement with a UN-commanded force. The arrival of the United Nations operation in the Congo, or the ONUC, was initially welcomed by Lumumba and the central government, who believed the UN would help suppress the secessionist states. ONUC's initial mandate, however, only covered the maintenance of law and order. Viewing the secessions as an internal political matter, Hammarskjöld refused to use UN troops to assist the central Congolese government against them. He argued that doing so would represent a loss of impartiality and breach Congolese sovereignty. Lumumba also sought the assistance of the United States government of Dwight D. Eisenhower, who refused to provide unilateral military support. Frustrated, Lumumba turned to the Soviet Union, who agreed to provide weapons, logistical and material support. Around 1,000 Soviet military advisors soon landed in the Congo. Lumumba's actions distanced him from the rest of the government, especially Kasavubu, who feared the implications of Soviet intervention. The Americans also feared that a Soviet-aligned Congo could form the basis of a major expansion of communism into Central Africa. With Soviet support, 2,000 Congolese troops launched a major offensive against South Kasai. The attack was successful, but during the course of the offensive, the Congolese army became involved in infighting between the Baluba and Benlulula ethnic groups, and took part in a number of large massacres of Luba civilians, resulting in the killing of around 3,000 people. The involvement of the Soviet Union alarmed the United States. Successive US administrations, with the influence of the Central Intelligence Agency, or the CIA, perceived the Congo as a potential East-West battleground. The American government under Eisenhower, in line with Belgian views, had long believed that Lumumba was a communist and that the Congo could be on track to become a strategically placed Soviet client state. A month after independence, the CIA station in the Congo cabled Washington that they believe Congo experiencing classic communist effort to take over government. The CIA director himself, Alan Dulles, warned of a communist takeover of the Congo with disastrous consequences for the interests of the free world. Dulles also authorized the opening of a fund of up to $100,000 for a program designed to replace the existing government of Patrice Lumumba with a so-called pro-Western group. Now, Lumumba's appeal for Soviet support split the government and led to mounting pressure from Western countries to remove him from power. In addition, both Shombe and Kolonji appealed to Kazavubu, who they believed to be both a moderate and federalist, to move against Lumumba's centralism and resolve the secession issue. Meanwhile, Mobutu took effective control of the army, routing foreign aid and promotions to specific unions and officers to secure their allegiance. On 5 September 1960, Kasavubu announced on the national radio that he had unilaterally dismissed Lumumba, using the massacres in South Kasai as a pretext and with the promise of American backing. Andrew Cordier, the American UN representative in the Congo, used his position to block communications by Lumumba's faction and to prevent a coordinated MNCL reaction to the news. However, the Congolese parliament supported Lumumba and denounced Kasavubu's action. Lumumba attempted to dismiss Kasavubu from his position, but could not get support for this, precipitating a constitutional crisis. In order to resolve the deadlock, Joseph Désiré Mobutu launched a bloodless coup and replaced both Kasavubu and Lumumba with a College of Commissionnaires General, the Collège des Commissaires Généraux, consisting of a panel of university graduates. Soviet military advisors were ordered to lead. Allegedly, the coup was intended to force the politicians to take a cooling-off period before they could resume control. In practice, however, Mobutu sided with Kasavubu against Lumumba, who was placed under house arrest, guarded by Ghanaian UN troops and Congolese soldiers. Kasavubu was reappointed president by Mobutu in February 1961. From the coup onwards, Mobutu was able to exert considerable power in Congolese politics behind the scenes. Following Kasavubu's reinstatement, there was an attempted reconciliation between the Congolese factions. Shombe began negotiations for the end of the secession and the formation of a Congo Federation. Although a compromise agreement was reached, it was prevented from taking effect as negotiations broke down amid personal animosity between Kasavubu and Shombe. An attempted reconciliation in July 1961 led to the formation of a new government led by Cyril Abdullah, which brought together deputies from both Lumumba and South Kasai factions, but failed to bring a reconciliation with Katanga. Members of the MNCL fled to Stanleyville, where, led by Antoine Gizenga, they formed a rebel government in November 1960, in opposition to the central government in Leopoldville. the Gazenga government was recognized by some states, including the Soviet Union and China, as the official government of the Congo and could call on an approximate 5,500 troops compared to the central government's 7,000. Faced with UN pressure, the Gazenga government, however, collapsed in January 1962 after Gazenga was arrested. Lumumba escaped house arrest and fled eastwards towards Stanleyville, where he believed he could rally support. Pursued by troops loyal to Mobutu, Lumumba was captured on 1 December 1960 and thrown back to Leopoldville with his hands bound. Despite UN appeals to Kasavubu for due legal process, the Soviet Union denounced the UN as responsible for the arrest and demanded his release. A meeting of the UN Security Council was called on 7 December 1960 to consider Soviet demands that the UN seek Lumumba's immediate release, his restoration to the head of the Congolese government, and the disarming of Mobutu's forces. The pro-Lumumba resolution was defeated on 14 December 1960 by a vote of 8-2. Still in captivity, Lumumba was tortured and transported to Tasteville, and later to Katanga, where he was handed over to forces loyal to Shombe. On 17 January 1961, barely 6 months after he took power, Patrice Lumumba was executed by Katangese troops near Elizabethville. No one really knows what happened to Lumumba's body after that. In 1978, former CIA Africa specialist John Stockwell revealed that a ranking CIA officer had told him of driving around with Lumumba's body in the trunk of his car, trying to decide what to do with it. Lumumba's assassination made him a martyr and symbol of anti-imperialism all over Africa and elsewhere in the Third World, which ironically was what US officials had feared the most. Even Mobutu, when he eventually came into power, later felt compelled to build a memorial to his enemy and victim. Since its initial resolution of July 1960, the UN had issued further resolutions calling for the total withdrawal of Belgian and mercenary forces from Katanga in progressively stronger terms. By 1961, the ONUC comprised nearly 20,000 men, although their mandate prevented them from taking sides. The ONUC still had the mandate to arrest foreign mercenaries wherever they encountered them. In September 1961, an attempt to detain a group of Katangese mercenaries without violence during Operation Morthor went wrong and turned into a firefight. On 18 September 1961, Hammarskjöld flew to Ndola, just across the border in northern Rhodesia, to attempt to broker a ceasefire between UN and Katangese troops. His aircraft was mysteriously shot down before landing at Ndola Airport, killing him and everybody else on board. In stark contrast to Hammarskjöld's attempts to pursue a moderate policy in the Congo, his successor, U Thant, supported a more radical policy of direct involvement in the conflict. Restated American support for the UN mission and the murder of 10 Italian UN pilots in Port Ampan in November 1961 strengthened international demands to resolve the situation. In April 1962, UN troops occupied South Kasai. On the night of 29 and 30 September 1962, South Kasai military commanders launched a coup d'etat in Bakwanga against the Kolonist regime. On 5 October 1962, central government troops again arrived in Bakwanga to support the mutineers and help suppress the last Kolonist loyalists, marking the end of South Kasai secession. UN Resolution 169, issued in November 1961, called for ONUC to respond to the deteriorating human rights situation and prevent the outbreak of a full-scale civil war. The resolution completely rejected Katanga's claim to statehood and authorized ONUC troops to use all necessary force to assist the central government of the Congo in the restoration and maintenance of law and order. The Katangese made further provocations, and in response, ONUC launched Operation Unicut to dismantle Katangese roadblocks and seize strategic positions around Elizabethville. Faced with international pressure, Shombe signed the Kitona Declaration in December 1961, in which he agreed in principle to accept the authority of the central government and state constitution, and to abandon any claim to Katangese independence. Following the declaration, however, talks between Shombe and Adula reached a deadlock, while Katangese troops continued to harass UN troops. Diminishing support and Belgium's increasing reluctance to support Katanga demonstrated that the state could not survive indefinitely. On 11 December 1962, Belgian Foreign Minister Paul-Henri Spaak declared that the Belgian government would support the UN or the Central Congolese government should they attempt to end the Katangese secession through force. On 24 December 1962, UN troops and the Katangese gendarmes clashed against Elizabethville and fighting broke out. After attempts to reach a ceasefire failed, UN troops launched Operation Grand Slam and occupied Elizabethville, prompting Shombe to leave the country. A ceasefire was agreed upon soon thereafter. Indian UN troops, exceeding their orders, then occupied Jadoville, preventing Katangese loyalists from regrouping. Gradually, the UN overran the rest of the Katanga, and on 17 January 1963, Shombe surrendered his final stronghold of Kolwezi, effectively ending the Katangese secession. Following the end of the Katanga secession, political negotiations began to reconcile the disparate political groups. The negotiations coincided with the formation of an emigre political group, the Conseil National de Libération, or the CNL, by dissident Lumumbists and others in neighboring Congo-Brazzaville. The negotiations culminated in the creation of a new revised constitution, known as the Doulouburg Constitution, after the city in which it was written, to create a compromise balance of power. The new constitution increased the power of the presidency, ending the system of joint consultation between president and prime minister, and appeased federalists by increasing the number of provinces from 6 to 21, while increasing their autonomy. The constitution also changed the name of the state from the Republic of the Congo to Democratic Republic of the Congo. It was ratified in a constitutional referendum in June 1964, and parliament was dissolved to await new elections. Kasavubu appointed Shombe, the exiled Katangese leader, as interim prime minister. Although personally capable and supported as an anti-communist by Western powers, Shombe was denounced by other African leaders such as King Hassan II of Morocco as an imperialist puppet for his role in the Katangese secession. Under Shombe's interim government, fresh elections were scheduled for 30 March, and the rebellion broke out in the central and eastern parts of the Congo. The period of political crisis had led to widespread disenchantment with the central government brought in by independence. Demands for second independence from political infighting in the capital, as well as kleptocracy, grew. The term kleptocracy refers to a government whose corrupt leaders use political power to appropriate the wealth of their nation, typically by embezzling or misappropriating government funds at the expense of the wider population. The second independence slogan was taken up by Congolese revolutionaries, including Pierre Mulele, who had served in the Lumumba government. The political instability of the Congo helped to channel wider discontentment into outright revolt. Disruption in the rural Congo began with agitation by the Lumumbists, led by Mulele, among the Pende and Mbundu peoples. By the end of 1963, there was unrest in regions of central and eastern Congo. The Kwilu Rebellion broke out on 16 January 1964 in the cities of Idiofa and Gungu in Kwilu province. Further disruption and uprisings then spread to Kivu in the east and later to Albertville, sparking further insurrection elsewhere in the Congo and the outbreak of the largest Simba Rebellion. The rebels began to expand their territory and rapidly advanced northwards, capturing Port Empine, Stanleyville, Polis, and Lisala between July and August 1964. The rebels, who called themselves Simbas from the Kiswahili word for lion, had a populist but vague ideology, loosely based on communism, which prioritized equality and aimed to increase overall wealth. Most of the active revolutionaries were young men who hoped that the rebellion would provide them with opportunities which the government had not. The Simbas believed that by following a moral code, they could become invulnerable to bullets. Magic was also very important to the rebels, who also made extensive use of witchcraft to protect themselves and also demoralize government troops. As they advanced, the rebels perpetrated numerous massacres in the territory they captured, in order to remove political opposition and terrorize the population. The ONUC was in the process of withdrawing when the rebellion started and had only 5,500 personnel, most of whom were deployed in the eastern part of the country and stranded by the conflict. Straggling Western missionaries retreated to their respective embassies, which in turn requested UN assistance. A small force of peacekeepers was assembled, and operations continued throughout March and April and resulted in the successful recovery of over 100 missionaries. The rebels founded a state, the People's Republic of the Congo, or République Populaire du Congo, with its capital at Stanleyville, and Christophe Gabenye as president. The new state was supported by the Soviet Union and China, which supplied it with arms, as did various African states, most notably Tanzania. It was also supported by Cuba, which sent a team of over 100 advisors led by Che Guevara to advise the Simbas on tactics and doctrine. The Simba Rebellion coincided with a wide escalation of the Cold War amid the Gulf of Tonkin incident, and Piero Leguizas contended that US government officials were preparing for a full-scale military intervention, as was happening in Vietnam. However, the rebellion was quickly defeated, and therefore it was unnecessary. After its early string of successes, the Simba Rebellion began to encounter local resistance as it encroached on areas outside of the MNCL's old domain. The People's Republic of the Congo also suffered from a lack of coherent social and economic policy, contributing to an inability to administer its own territory. From the end of August 1964, the rebels began to lose ground to the government forces. Albertville and Lisala were recaptured in late August and early September. Shombe, backed by Mobutu, recalled many of his former mercenaries from the Katangese secession to oppose the Simba. Mercenaries, led by Mad Mike Hall and mostly whites from Central and Southern Africa, were formed into a unit known as Five Commando. The unit served as the spearhead of the Congolese army, but were known for widespread unsanctioned killing, torture, looting, and mass rapes in recaptured rebel areas. The mercenaries were also materially supported by the CIA. In November 1964, the Simbas rounded up the remaining white population of Stanleyville and its surrounding areas. The whites were held hostage in the Victoria Hotel in the city to use as bargaining tools. In order to recover the hostages, Belgian parachute troops were flown to the Congo in American aircraft to intervene. On 24 November, as part of Operation Dragon Rouge, Belgian paratroopers landed in Stanleyville and quickly secured the hostages. In total, around 70 hostages and 1,000 Congolese civilians were killed, but the vast majority of hostages were evacuated. The Belgian troops were only under orders to liberate the hostages, rather than push the Simbas out of the city, but the attack nevertheless broke the back of the Eastern insurrection, which never recovered. The Simba leadership went into exile in disarray and severe disagreement. As a result of the intervention, Shombe lost the support of Kasavubu and Mobutu and was dismissed from his post as Prime Minister in October 1965. Soon after Dragon Rouge, the army and mercenary troops captured Stanleyville and put an end to the Simba rebellion. Pockets of Simba resistance continued to hold out in the Eastern Congo, most notably in South Kivu, where Laurent Désiré Kabila led a cross-border insurgency which lasted until the 1980s. In the scheduled March 1965 elections, Shombe's Convention Nationale Congolais, or CONACO, won a large majority of the seats, but a large part of his party soon defected to form the new Front Démocratique Congolais, or the FDC, making the overall result unclear, as CONACO controlled the Chamber of Deputies, while the FDC controlled the Senate. Kasavubu, attempting to use the situation to block Shombe, appointed an anti-Shombe leader of the FDC to be Prime Minister Designate in November 1965, but the largely pro-Shombe parliament refused to ratify the appointment. With the government in near paralysis, Mobutu eventually seized power in a bloodless coup, ostensibly to stop the deadlock on 25 November 1965. Under the auspices of a regime d'exception, or the equivalent of a state of emergency, Mobutu assumed sweeping, almost absolute power for 5 years, after which he claimed democracy would be restored. Mobutu's coup, which promised both economic and political stability, was supported by the United States and other Western governments, and his rule initially met widespread popularity. He increasingly took other powers, abolishing the post of Prime Minister in 1966 and dissolving Parliament in 1967. Once established as the sole source of political power, Mobutu gradually consolidated his control in the Congo. The number of provinces was reduced and their autonomy curtailed, resulting in a highly centralized state. Mobutu increasingly placed his supporters in remaining positions of power. In 1967, to demonstrate his legitimacy, he created a party, the Mouvement Populaire de la Révolution, or the MPR, which until 1990 was the nation's only legal political party under Mobutu's new constitution. In 1971, the state was renamed Zaire and efforts were made to remove all colonial influences. Zaireanization, or l'authenticité, was a disastrous social engineering scheme which aimed to rid the Congo of the lingering remnants of colonialism and continuing influence of Western culture, creating a more centralized and singular national identity. It called for the nationalizing of foreign businesses and redistributing them. It was supposed to represent a combination of both a nationalistic impulse for economic independence in a Cold War world split between East and West, as well as personal aggrandizement for Mobutu. Administratively, expropriation was managed by various government ministries, and most recipients of the expropriation were ministers or members of the party's political bureau or top army officers. It thus represented a financial handout for the country's political elite. Mobutu spoke of Zaireanization as promoting radical economic nationalism to help the economic situation of the country's masses, but instead it promoted the creation of a landed gentry to encourage greater investment in the countryside. Therefore, the ruling elite transformed state autonomy and economic sovereignty into a tool for its own enrichment. Despite initial successes by the time of its disestablishment, Mobutu's rule was characterized by widespread cronyism, corruption, and economic mismanagement. Mobutu amassed a personal fortune estimated to be in the billions of dollars, while most of the population suffered from severe malnutrition. In the years after the Congo crisis, Mobutu was able to remove many opposition figures from the crisis who might threaten his control. Shombe was sent into a second exile in 1965 after being accused of treason. In 1967, Shombe was sentenced to death in absentia, and the same year was kidnapped in an aeroplane hijacking and held under arrest in Algeria. His death in 1969, allegedly from natural causes, has provoked speculation that the Mobutu government may have been involved. Mulele was also lured back to the Congo from exile by the promise of an amnesty, but was tortured and murdered. The issues of federalism, ethnicity in politics, and state centralization were not resolved by the crisis and partly contributed to a decline in support for the concept of the state among Congolese people. Mobutu was strongly in favor of centralization, and one of his first acts in 1965 was to reunify provinces and abolish much of the independent legislative capacity. Subsequent loss of faith in central government is one of the reasons that the Congo had been labeled as a failed state, and has contributed violence by factions advocating ethnic and localized federalism. Local insurgencies continued in the eastern Congo into the 1980s and left a legacy of instability along the Congo's eastern borders. Laurent Désiré Kabila, who had led an anti-Mobutu insurrection during the crisis, succeeded in deposing Mobutu in 1997 and becoming president of the restored Democratic Republic of the Congo. He was later succeeded by his son, Joseph Kabila. The Congo crisis holds great significance in the collective memory of the Congolese people. In particular, Lumumba's murder is viewed in the context of the memory as a symbolic moment in which the Congo lost its dignity in the international realm and the ability to determine its future, which has since been controlled by the West. Many Congolese view the problems of the crisis as unresolved and believe that the Congo's self-determination has yet to be secured from Western conspiracies. The crisis caused the newly independent African states to consider their allegiances and internal ties. In particular, it led to the division of African states into factions. Moderate-leaning states joined the Brazzaville group, which called for a degree of unity between Francophone or French-speaking African states and the maintenance of ties with France. Radical states joined the Casablanca group, which called for a Pan-African federation. The chaotic violence of the crisis and the fate of the country's whites, many of whom entered northern and southern Rhodesia as refugees, contributed to the widespread belief among whites that black nationalist politicians were not ready to govern, and prompted fears that immediate majority rule in Rhodesia might lead to a similar situation. After negotiations with Britain repeatedly broke down, southern Rhodesia's predominantly white government declared independence unilaterally in 1965. The Katangese secession would prove to be politically influential in Africa. During the Chadian Civil War between 1965 and 1979, the Front de la Libération Nationale du Tchad, or FRONAT, explicitly rejected secessionism in its bid to remove the southern-backed government of François Tombalbaye, following the experiences of the Katanga secession, officially stating that there will be no Katanga in Chad. In the Nigerian Civil War between 1967 and 1970, the ethnically Igbo region of Biafra seceded from Nigeria, which it accused of privileging the interests of northern ethnic groups and discriminating against the Igbo. The secessions of Biafra and Katanga have frequently been compared, but unlike Katanga, Biafra achieved limited official international recognition and rejected the support of Western multinational companies involved in the local oil industry. Biafra was defeated in 1970 and reintegrated into Nigeria. In many ways, the road to independence of the Congo was similar to the road to independence of other sub-Saharan African countries. However, its processes of decolonization often took more drastic and more tragic turns. The failure of the Congolese state came from both external and internal sources. We have seen that the Belgians were never ready to give up their commercial interests, and with the help of the United States of America, who saw the Congo as vital in the fight against communism, they were able to retain those interests, but at the expense of political stability within the country. Internal factors such as factionalism, ethnic rivalry, and disagreement regarding the form of government also led to disastrous consequences for the country and its people. Cronyism, widespread corruption, and political suppression was later added to the list. As Haskin notes, sadly, the Congo had endured centuries of slavery and decades of King Leopold's genocidal policies before it was birthed as a new nation in a welter of confusion and fratricidal violence. And in the years to come, under Mobutu, it would know only hunger and deprivation. This was the legacy that the developed world had bestowed on the country by failing to fill the void that the Belgians had left behind, a story that persists today. It serves not only as a reminder of the far-reaching consequences of colonialism, but also warns us that with the hope that independence and decolonization brought to Africa, the sudden withdrawal of authority led to a new kind of exploitation, a new kind of crisis, and the killing of hope for generations to come.